and a very good early morning to you, boys and girls. It's Good Friday morning, the 14th of April 2017. Welcome to a little bit of a late night chat today for you, boys and girls. Yes, here we are, and hopefully the synchronisation will keep up today. I've no idea. The annoying thing about when something goes wrong is if you don't know what caused it, therefore it could happen again. You know what I mean? And I was watching back on the show, usually after, as soon as I finished the show, I have a very quick look at the recording to write the summary for it to go up as a recording. And I notice straight away if there's something wrong. But once that's gone out, there's not a lot you can do with it other than completely sort of get it back into some software, then start splitting it apart and trying to match it all up. And it does take a long time. So I tend generally just leave that now and put a little warning message. Anyway, good evening to you, boys and girls. Nice to have you with us very late at night today. I'm glad you enjoyed my little piano tunes on the sort of preview video I did earlier. I played you a couple of piano tunes. I did have you fooled at first, though, didn't I? Yes, you actually thought that piano, the classical piece, you thought that was me playing that one. That wasn't me. However, the church music was. So I'm not completely useless. I don't consider myself much of a good piano player, really. I just play for myself. I used to play the organ at church years ago, but I stopped doing that. And I found it's... Playing the organ at a church, it's a bit like being in a show. I can only describe it as that. And you're forever listening for a cue, you know, waiting to come in at the right moment. And you worry about making a mistake. And we all make mistakes doing it. Oh, God, I mean, watch the show, dear. Have you seen the amount of mistakes I watch in here? And you're forever worrying about making a mistake. And I just couldn't handle it anymore. And that's funny, isn't it? I was all right when I was much younger. I did it when I was about 21 years old. And then there was a big gap. And I went back a few years ago and I did it for a while. And I just, now and again, I'd make a mistake. But oh no, you know, you just hit the wrong note. And I don't play quietly. I have it at full volume. Yes. So I'm glad you enjoyed the music earlier on, which was just one of the, I didn't intend to do that. I intend to fool you with that thing. And then people started asking for requests, so we played the old Rugged Cross for Lily. Faye Wood's with us this evening. Good evening, Faye. And Angela enjoyed it, so I'm glad you did. You had a little pop tune, you had a bit of Britney Spears. Carl Gambrell was impressed. Britain's most famous hairdresser. Well, not quite, but he's good at it. Good at it. I think you're in competition with my niece now, aren't you? My niece is ready to drop her baby. Oh yes. My niece, it's her third child. And she, her date is not due yet. However, my sister informs me that it's very, I don't know what it means actually, it's very low down now. And my niece actually thinks it's going to come at the weekend. Although she hasn't packed up work yet. She carries, honestly, she's got this great big, and it's massive. This baby is massive. It really is. It's enormous, this baby. Christ knows how they come out like that. Oh, the pain. I can't imagine the pain, ladies. I really can't. So I think my niece is possibly going to have her baby at the weekend. Let me just turn this phone off because it's making a noise, isn't it? I'm sorry about that. Just a minute. You can hear that buzzing. That's messages pouring into the studios of United Kingdom Talk. Justin says, I'm not religious, as you know, but the old Rugged Cross always brings a tear to my glass eye. Callum wants to learn the piano. Oh yeah, you can do that, Callum. Can I suggest you think about buying a piano? Can I suggest a second-hand one from eBay? See how you get on with it. Or maybe you've got a little key. Have you got a keyboard? Can you play it? And I would also recommend an electric piano. I've got an electric piano myself. And you don't have to worry about tuning them or anything like that. They just remain in tune. You know, you plug them in and they either work or they don't. They don't go out of tune. And I'm very happy with my I've got a Yamaha Clarinova, something like that. All right, so highly recommended there. Let's say hello to some of the early people who are with us on the show tonight. Greetings, Kareem. You're the first message in there. We should have a little competition to see who can put the first message up there. Today, it's Kareem. Greetings, Kareem. A very good morning to you. Look at this, 20 past 12 in the morning on Good Friday. Ashley's with us. Good afternoon. Good evening, Ashley. Welcome. I thought you'd be out somewhere tonight. I'm very surprised. Looking at some of you on there who are with us this morning, I thought you'd be out somewhere on Maundy Thursday. Generally, bars and clubs are very, very busy on a Maundy Thursday, the one before Good Friday. I'm surprised you're all in. Rod Brown, good evening, Rod. Gustav says, evening. What's the number? Let's get ringing it. We're not opening phone lines yet, dear. Too early. I haven't done any stories yet. God's sake, man. Do you want the phone number up now? What, really? It's a bit early, isn't it? Bit early for phone numbers. Dear me. Give me a chance to say a couple of words. I've hardly said a sentence yet. Barely been here half an hour. Oh, and also, please let me know if the synchronisation goes out. I would like to know that, if you could, if you do notice it. I mean, not by a little amount. It's usually out a little amount. I know that, because it's not... Let's be honest, it's not the BBC. You know, some of you are surprised at that, aren't you? I can tell. Some of you are surprised that it's not the BBC. It's not. It's just me sitting in a little studio. Oh, by the way, do you like the shirt? My mate bought this back. He's recently been to New York and he bought this back. It's a Tommy Hilfiger. Tommy Hilfiger. But I can't like it. It's bloody tight around the stomach. Very, very tight around the stomach. Good evening to Joey Miller. By the way, Gustav, are you going to open another bottle of White Lightning, darling? You enjoy it. Enjoy the show while you're having that. That's the trouble, you see. I'm a little bit worried about opening phone lines at this time of night because people like you have been on the cider all day. I don't know what you'll say. You might be offensive to people, Gustav. Be very, very careful when you're on that White Lightning, dear. Good evening to Joey Millen. Evening, Joey. Carl is with us. Hello, Carl. I thought you'd be working tonight as well, Carl. All these people are off tonight. Zach Thompson. Hello, Zach. Was it your birthday the other day, was it? Did I wish you happy birthday the other day? I think I did. I can't remember now. That was at least a show ago, wasn't it? It's gone. As soon as I finish, it's gone out of my head. I don't know what I've said. No idea. People come up to me in this street. Oh, what you said the other day really offended me. Did it? What was it? I don't know what it was. No idea. Was it me? Or was you watching someone else who looks similar to me? There's a few of us around. Look at Theresa May. She looks similar to me, doesn't she? Obviously, I'm more feminine than her. Joey says, I'm sorry I missed your morning show. Oh, don't worry about that, Joey. You will notice the synchronisation's out, though, between the face and the voice. Better turn the picture off and just listen, all right? Louis. Hello, Louis. Happy Easter to you as well, Louis. Easter. Not quite yet. We're not there yet. We're not yet there. Sunday is Easter. And I do hope you're not giving Easter eggs out yet. Huh? Very, very bad. My niece... Tracy, she's the one who's about to have the baby. Anyway, she's bringing the other two children over to my caravan. I don't own a caravan. I hire a caravan at Tattershaw Lakes here, sometime during next week while I'm up there visiting. And she's asked me to do an Easter egg hunt for them. So I've got to get a couple of little Easter eggs and hide them somewhere in the caravan. And I said, oh, well, they'll find them easy. She said, I'm telling you, they won't. They have got the worst eyesight, children, apparently. They can be standing there looking at an Easter egg and not being able to see it. So I'll have a laugh with that and we'll try and do some videos while we're up there as well. I do love seeing the children. I've got 5 great nieces and nephews, 1 on the way. There's my niece's children, that's George and Emily. In that order, you know, oldest one first, George and Emily. And there's my nephew's children. There's Evie, there's Harry, and there's Olivia. Those of you that know about Olivia, she has some serious disabilities at the moment. And once again, she's in hospital at the moment. She's having a lung breathing difficulties she's got at the moment. So once again, she's in hospital. She spends an awful lot of time in hospital, that girl. She really does, and the parents, my nephew and his wife, do not have a good time. But there you go, you know, you've got to make the best of it and do the best you can for her, and they certainly do. So that's what's happening at the moment, and I shall look forward to seeing them and playing Easter. I hope someone will hide an Easter egg for me. I don't want to be left out, dear. You know, I am hoping that I too will have Easter eggs hidden from me. I want to play the game. Yes, want to play the game. Hello to Becky. Today it's your birthday. Is it really, Becky? I usually do the birthdays at the end of the show. But as it's your birthday and you're reminding me now, then happy birthday, Becky. I will also sing to you along with everyone else at the end of the show. But as you have taken the time and effort tonight, darling, to tell me personally it's your birthday, then happy birthday, Becky. What are you going to do tonight on your birthday? Anything exciting? What are you doing, or later on perhaps, what are you doing later on for your birthday on this Good Friday? Are you going out somewhere? What are you doing, darling? Let us know. Good evening to Mike Cullen up in Newcastle. Evening, Mike. Rachel Davis, good morning, Rachel. Nice to see you, darling. Mary Warren, blessings for Olivia. Thank you very much, Mary. Thank you. You could never be short of a prayer for her, to be honest, Mary. Always something going on, darling. All right, so it would be very nice, that would be. Mark's with us. Good afternoon to Mark. Blessings on Good Friday. Mark Cording's there. So what now, why aren't you out at karaoke tonight? Why aren't people out tonight? I can't understand it. Usually Maundy Thursday people go out. Mike says, did you listen to Ian Collins at 10 o'clock? No, what was he talking about today? What was he talking about today, Mike? Do let us know. We'll open the phone line if you want to call in at some point today, boys and girls. Then feel free to do so. Phone lines are open now. 020-8144-3477 is my late night number, OK? 020-8144-3477 is the phone-in number, as always. If you've got Skype, we've got a Skype as well. The Skype username is United Kingdom Talk, all one word. United Kingdom Talk. So once again, phone number, at any point you want to call in about anything, 020-8144-3477. And the Skype name is United Kingdom Talk. Okay, don't be shy. Mary says, are you sure you want an egg? No, no, don't bring an egg in, Mary. Not tomorrow. It's Good Friday tomorrow. Today it's Good Friday. Mustn't have eggs until Easter Sunday or after. Not allowed before. Thank you. An Easter egg. Oh, don't be... don't be bringing an egg into one of the pubs, Mary, and hiding it in there. I know where you're hiding it. You'll probably hide it under your dress. See, I knew straight away, even before... I'm not stupid, dear. Or you'll disguise it as a maraca or something like that, won't you? Yes, I know your game, my dear. Are you streaming live on Sunday night? I really enjoy your shows. Sunday nights, what am I doing? No, Sunday night, I'm away. I'm away Sunday night. I'm at my sister's. My mate who bought me this shirt, too tight, but I mean, it's probably a large. It's got to be a large, but it's a bit tight around my stomach, actually. He'll be coming several times a day to look after the cat. And that's hard work now, looking after the cat. I don't know what you think, boys and girls. Perhaps I'll ask you. I don't know if you've had a pet. But recently I restricted the cat to half of the kitchen. Because she is completely incontinent, as you know. I've got the entire floor covered in puppy pads and newspapers. Sometimes it's worse than others. The other morning it was particularly bad. I mean, I had to chuck all the newspapers away, because what she does, she does her business and then starts walking round and round and round in it. Now, if I've gone straight out into the kitchen 10 minutes later, that's okay. But if it's happened overnight, she's walked around this thing for hours. She literally walks around and around in a circle. So what I've done now is I've now made the restriction even a little bit more, and she's restricted to the utility room, which I suppose is about, well, you can't see this room. That's a stupid thing to say, which it's quite a small room. On the other hand, if she just walks in circles all the time, she doesn't need the room anyway. And what I do is whenever I go into the kitchen, I pick her up and put her out in the garden, and I leave her out there for an hour so she can have a bit of exercise out there. I don't think that... do you think that's all right? I mean, it's a lot easier to manage than chucking away newspaper and all that. We've got Mike calling in from Newcastle. Hello, Mike. How are you? All right?
Good morning, Chris.
Morning to you. Nice to see you, mate.
Well, I can't see you.
What do you mean? Well, of course you can't see me. That's because you're on the phone now, dear. You want to get one of those phones with moving pictures. It's all the rage, you know, all the rage. And in colour. Can you believe that?
I know, I was watching you before.
How are you, Mike? Now, you're talking about Ian Collins. You sent me a message. Did you see Ian Collins? What happened on there then?
Well, the US military have dropped a non-atomic bomb on Afghanistan.
Oh, yes. The world's biggest bomb or something. Is this the one that's 7 metres long? I mean, how on earth do you carry something like that?
But what a stupid idea, though.
Well, mind you, planes can take off when I'm sitting on there, so it must be possible.
This is true.
It's just there's a few things going on at the moment which I must say are starting to worry me a bit. with the Russian and the Americans. I think there's you know, three of them really. It's the King Ching Kong. Oh, I can't think of his name. You know, the North Korea bloke, King Jing
Jong Un.
Kim
Jong Un.
Kim Jong Un. That's him.
That's him.
I've got that King Jim in it. No, it's not, is it? Go on, say it again.
Kim Jong Un.
Kim Jong Un.
Yes. Un.
Right. So there's him, there's the Russian bloke, and the American bloke, and they're all a little bit off their rocker, all of them. Actually,
what a stupid idea, though, isn't it? I mean, you know, dropping a bomb on Afghanistan. What a stupid idea.
They're trying to get the tunnels, aren't they? Instead of trying to get the tunnels or something.
Is that what they're trying to do?
You know, I mean, my brother-in-law doesn't watch the news because it depresses him. And I've always thought, oh, it's a bit silly that, not watching the news. You know, you need to know what's going on. But actually, you know, I'm watching it sometimes and I turn it off. I don't want to know.
I try not to watch it, but I can't help watching the regional news.
It seems to be getting rather dangerous out there. In fact... Even more bad news about Russia today. I have to say, out of the three of them, King Jong Un, and now I've got that wrong again, haven't I? Oh, it doesn't matter. King Jong Un, Mr. Trump, and Mr. Putin. Out of the three of them, I think Mr. Putin's probably the only one with his head screwed on properly.
Well, that's right, because I reckon that Donald Trump will inevitably start World War III.
I think it's a very, very worrying possibility.
It's very, very scary. Mm. Very scary indeed. Because
I'm starting
what if
to get a little bit itchy, you know, and all that about this whole thing? Yeah, yeah.
But what if they can't get to America? They'll get to us, won't they?
What, the Russians?
No. The people from Afghanistan. You know, what they call it, ISIS.
ISIS, well, they're all over the place now.
They've done it before, they'll do it again.
There isn't like a specific country they're doing. There was that business in Sweden. Wasn't there somewhere else today? Was it Germany or something today as well?
I think it was Germany, yes. Aye. Yeah.
Was it Düsseldorf? Did I see Düsseldorf or something?
Düsseldorf?
Is it Düsseldorf? Clutching at straws here, maybe. No, maybe not Düsseldorf. I'm sure I saw something today. I can't remember where it was now, and I kind of switched off and I went, oh, I don't want this to see this again. You know, but it's all very worrying. But also, are you ready for this? Russia has pulled out the Eurovision Song Contest, Mike.
Have they? Really?
Now, I've got to say, I think they do some damn good songs. Very good songs. But apparently Russia has pulled out the Eurovision Song Contest following a bitter dispute with Ukraine over its entrant. The Russian television station Channel 1 has announced it will not broadcast the contest this year or take part because its contestant was controversially barred from host country Ukraine. And she's in a wheelchair. This Ukraine banned 27-year-old Yulia Samolova.
Because she's in a wheelchair.
Yeah, who is wheelchair bound because she performed in Crimea, which Moscow annexed in 2014. So they've pulled out, dear. Oh, it's all very political, dear. All very political. But I tell you what, I've had a word with Nigel Farage about this whole Eurovision Song Contest.
I hope you phoned into LBC to talk to Nigel Farage about this.
Well, if we don't win the Eurovision Song Contest, then it needs to be held again until we do win. We need recounts until we get to the correct result, and that's it.
Britain needs to win something.
Well, we did quite well at the Olympics. Both last two Olympics were doing well, aren't we?
Yes, very well.
Are you a very athletic person at all, Mike? Do you do running or swimming or anything like that?
I don't swim, I don't run, but I go for walks.
That's good.
About three times a week.
In fact, I think you find walking is better than running, Mike.
Definitely.
All right.
Anyway, onto something happy.
Happy!
Onto something happy. How's the karaoke going?
Karaoke going very well, thank you. Yeah.
I seen it last night, it was brilliant.
I know you watch our little shows, don't you? Do you watch the whole thing or just dip in and out? Most people dip in and out. And so yeah. I think it might be a bit much to watch 4 hours of that, really.
Oh, it's good. It's really good.
I love it. I'm so lucky to have fallen into... I literally just fell into karaoke. That was an accident. It was an accident years and years ago. And then I stopped doing it. And then I did it again. And it's kind of the main thing that I do now. Yeah, I much prefer it to the DJing anyway. I should
the
be DJing.
Karaoke, though, is you have to you know, be able to sing yourself, don't you?
To a point, yeah. I certainly don't class myself as a good singer, but I'm a karaoke singer, like most of us. We're karaoke. If you accept that you are a karaoke singer, then you do fine. But some people think they're like big superstars, you know, and they although they don't know it, other people talk about them.
The next Michael Jackson or the next Cher?
Oh, Lord. You know, some people do think they're absolute superstars and they take it very, very seriously. And often those sort of people, they don't like the way I do it because I tend to send the whole thing up. Although, that being said, I never, ever take the mick out of anyone. Never, never, ever, ever take the mick out of anyone. But I do send the whole thing up, the whole idea of it. You know, I like to muck around with tambourines and cymbals and things like that, and generally try and get people to have a good time. If people have gone out smiling, then I'm happy. Do you know, I've just noticed that there's still no dust on my newly dusted shelves in front of me. I'm very proud of that. I dusted them for the first time in about 3 years the other night.
Have you had the pledge out, have you?
Ian, I'll tell you something else I've noticed. it was pledge, actually. I'll tell you something else I've noticed, Mike. You must have noticed it. Do you still watch these shows occasionally?
Yes, of course I do.
Have you seen me sneeze recently? No.
No,
it
I
must
haven't.
Have been the dust in front of me. There you go. So what I need to do now is dust the rest of it. You know, because a bit over there, I can see a lot over there. And this room is just full of stuff, Mike. It's full of stuff. There's on that, I'm looking at the top shelf, which you can, actually you can see on the other camera, 1 minute. A top shelf, which is up there. Those two shelves, 1, 2, 3 shelves. Okay. Mm-hmm. Those top two shelves, I haven't been up there for about 2 years. Honestly.
But what have you done to that room, though? Because it's been decorated about 3 or 4 times, hasn't it?
It's just the back that gets decorated. Literally, it's only the back.
Right over here.
Yeah, that's... And it's not expensive when you do it. That's that's simply a piece of blue, light blue material. But this was a bit different to the other material I've put up on the wall before, in that it's a bit stretchy. And it's really difficult to not have, kinks and folds in it. And
I thought you had wallpaper the whole room.
Eh?
I thought you had wallpaper the whole room.
Oh, no, you're joking, ain't you? No, I couldn't take that. Oh, it was just a nightmare. But I've got another spare room, which is three times the size of this room next door. And I'd like to move in there at some point. But that room would be next. I'm a terraced house, and that room would be next to my neighbour. Now, at the moment, you know, it's like 20 to 1 in the morning, okay? And there's an empty room in between me and the house next door. It may be that they could hear me then, and I wouldn't like that. You know, I'm a bit respectful of people's privacy and noise and all that business.
I live above a pub, so you know it's
oh
noise. Very noisy during the
I couldn't stand it. No.
Friday, Saturday and Sunday, it's very noisy.
I couldn't stand it.
When the barmaids leave, they don't exactly close the door in a civilized manner.
None of them do. They're all drunk, aren't they?
They slam the door, and I mean, you know, many times that's woke me up.
Yeah. Have you lived there very long, Mike?
Since November last year.
Oh, okay. Not too long then. Yeah. Do you think you'll not stay there then because of the noise?
I don't think I will because it's too noisy.
Yeah, I couldn't stand it. I mean, we lived in Roehampton, Peckham first. Then, but there were not many cars in the late 60s. You know, that wasn't noisy. Then we moved to Roehampton, but we weren't on a main road. Mm-hmm. Then I moved to Battersea for the very Earlsfield, and Battersea for the very short time I was married. And then when we split up, I went back to Roehampton. Then I got a flat in Wandsworth, and none of them were really on main roads. And I, where I live now, well, it's dead quiet out there now. You know, I could go for a walk now for an hour and probably not see anyone.
So what drove you to Berkshire then?
Pardon? Oh, grass and trees, grass and trees, grass and trees. I went from this to me, when I first moved here, this was the country. You know, it's actually a large town, but there's loads of pine trees and grass and there's a forest 5 minutes walk away from me. And I love all that, really. Now that I've been here for a while, I look at perhaps not like where my sister lives. That is the country. You know, that's where you can buy, say, if you wanted to live somewhere like the Lincolnshire Wolds, W-O-L-D-S, it's the Lincolnshire Wolds, have a look up there, and you can get like a little house or a bungalow, you know, not massive, couple of bedrooms, but to the back, to the sides, fields, all on its own, maybe a little road in the front.
And that lovely garden you have as well, it's a beautiful garden.
Oh, I love it. I love it. It's not massive, but those flowers in the middle, they're all now about 2 or 3 years old, what was done there. Yeah, and I got rid of that big shed. Do you remember the shed video? Did you ever see that one?
Yes, I've seen that one, yes. Yeah. Uh-huh.
So that the shed used to be there, and I cleared it and filled it with plants over a period of time. And they just come up, and they're what you call perennial plants, Mike. That means they come back every year. They're not like the summer bedding stuff. Mm-hmm. And you can put all these flowers in, and it looks wonderful for 6 months. And then the moment the frost comes, that's it, they're dead. And you pull them up and chuck them away again. In that bit in the middle, there are none of those. They are all perennial plants, and they come up and they go down, and a few bulbs and things like that in. And over the period of time, you'll see different stuff coming up and dying down. And I love it. I love sitting in there. And it is quiet, except for some bloke somewhere. And I don't know who it is, but he's got this, like, machine. It sounds like one of those saw things. And he starts... I nearly swore then, Mike. He starts bloody sawing up bits of wood or metal. Or it sounds like paving stones. Oh, it does my head in. I do like a bit of peace and quiet. Isn't it funny? And yet the job I do is all noise, and yet I prefer a quiet... I am such a quiet person. Before I came up here, and actually before I made that little promo video, did you see that with the piano earlier?
Yes, I did, but yes.
Did. Uh-huh. Okay, well, before I did that, I thought I'll just go and see how the cat is outside. Mm-hmm. So it's got a couple of automatic tunes on it, the piano. So you push a button and it starts playing a tune, as was the first tune that I played. You know, I was pretending to play it, but it wasn't. It was an automatic tune.
You play piano so well.
No, I don't. Honestly, I don't. It's quite amateur.
Oh, Chris, you do. You play piano so well.
Honestly, it's not. I can't play.
I can play piano that good.
I can't play in any key. I mean, generally it's C, F, or G... or the one with B flat, I don't even know what that is. D, I think D. I'm not very good with many black notes for some reason. I don't know why that is. Funnily enough, I was talking to a bloke the other day, and he teaches piano. And I said, oh, I play a bit of piano. He said, oh, how good are you? I said, well, I'm not very good, really. I said, I have a problem with the black notes. He said, that's because you were taught to play on white notes first. I said, do you mean? He said, nearly all teachers teach people to play with the white notes first. They need to do it the other way round. Then it works. I said, well, I'm probably, you know, I've been playing like that for years. And I think once you get into a habit, it's difficult to get out of as well, isn't it? You know? Anyway, so I thought I'd give the cat a little bit of a stroke. Because she's a, I don't know. She's not with it at all anymore. Anyway, so I turned the piano on and switched to an automatic tune on, and it was playing like a bit classical. I went into the kitchen, sat down on my little stool, picked up the cat and put her on my lap, and she was like nuzzling her head in between my
that's so cute.
Underneath my arm, you know, and she's really not with it. But the thing is, you know, when you pick her up, and you give her a bit of fuss, she does start purring. She does start purring, and she used to be in and out, you know, up and down the stairs. She used to sleep with me on the bed and all that. You couldn't do that now because you don't know when she's going to go. And you'd wake up and you might have a load of dirt next to you on the duvet. I just could, oh, God, no. No, oh, so she's restricted. Well, she's been in the kitchen for a few years now, and she's been very happy in there, the whole run of the kitchen. But I've had to restrict her now because she's just getting dirtier and dirtier.
Mm-hmm.
But if she needs to go to sleep, then it has to be for her benefit and not mine. That's the thing. You know, I need to see that she's really ill before I do anything like that. And she's not. She just can't help where she goes at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Have you got any pets?
My mum's got a kitten, but is very nervous for some reason.
Yeah, but some of them are.
She won't let you stroke her. If you go to stroke her and she's asleep, she'll get up and she'll walk off.
All right, okay.
maybe
if you just move your hand towards her nose and then just leave it there and wait for her to come to you or him, whatever it is.
Well, I've tried that, but I mean, it just doesn't seem to work.
Maybe she just hates you.
She hates everyone. She hates everyone. I mean, you go to stroke her, but she won't accept being stroked. You know, she'll move away from you.
Yeah.
And she'll jump down off the settee or whatever. And she'll just walk away from you. You know, she'll just run away.
Does she have the mad spells where they suddenly go running around the living room?
Yes. Aren't they? Yes.
What's all that about?
As they get older,
it does stop. But they can be sitting there asleep, and then suddenly they start running around the room like something possessed, don't they, cats?
Well, she seems to do it, though. It's first thing in the morning, last thing at night.
Yeah, yeah. It's odd, isn't it?
Other than that, she'll sleep all day.
Yeah.
And so I'll get up and then about, what? Oh, God. Obviously, 11 o'clock. She's up. She's out. She's about,
Yeah, it's bizarre.
You know, go and do anything.
Oh, Mike, I don't know.
And then trying to get her back to sleep is impossible.
Well, keep at it and see how it sleep. Goes, mate. All right, Mikey. Lovely to talk to you, sir.
Yes, you too, Chris.
Don't get too worried about the war. I think it's on a scale of 1 to 100. What's the possibility of a war now? I would say 25% to 30% at the moment.
I was going to say about 15% to 20%, but I think you're right. Mm. Yeah. So
I think it'd be terrible.
Right, I'll let somebody else phone in now, Chris.
Depends where it is and who. Oh God, I just can't. You can't imagine it. None of us have been for a war. Our parents have, but you know, they've got a lot worse things now than they had then that they could chuck at each other.
By the way, do you know the chord of B flat?
Is it G, the one that uses B flat? G A B flat C D E. No, it's not. Is it? What is it?
It's B flat D F.
D F,
B flat D F.
Da, da, da. Yes, B flat D and F. Yep. Okay.
That's the first inversion. Yep.
Thank you very much for your corrections, Mike.
No problem. Anytime.
You take care, darling. All right.
Okay.
Thanks for calling. Bye bye, Mike.
See ya.
Bye now.
Bye.
There's Mike Cullen. He does a little bit of a internet radio. Actually, he's up in Newcastle there. 0208 144 3477 is my phone number. Yeah, I've just realised actually I kind of a lot more, how would you say, relaxed at this time. Do you not think so? Rather than during the morning, when I do the morning shows, which most of the time they're in the morning and the afternoon, as you well know, I'm much hyper. Have you noticed that? Now I feel very, very relaxed. Even my voice is quieter, isn't it? I might have to turn the mic up in a minute. Oh, dear me. Let's go some of your messages. Mary says, instead of an egg, would you like a fish? What do I want a fish for? What on earth would I do with a fish, Mary? What, like a goldfish? Oh, they have a bad life, don't they? Going round and round in that blooming bowl all the time. I think it's dreadful the way goldfish... It should be illegal to keep goldfish like that. Just going round and round in the bowl all the time. What an awful life. I don't know. Hello to Dino. Dino's with us this morning. Morning, Dino. Louis says, Chris, you're a good karaoke singer and a great karaoke host. You attract good singers. I love watching your live feeds. You're very engaging and complimentary about your singers. Long may it continue. Well, that's the way to be, Lou. And to me, the karaoke's never been about the singing. It's always about the characters, the people having a go. You know, you need to be able to come and have a good time, even if you can't sing. Doesn't matter. Don't matter if you can't sing. Just come and have a good time and we'll all be happy, you know. Good morning to Justin Peacock, who's with us. Are you back in the UK now, Justin? Welcome back to the United Kingdom, dear. How lovely to have you back. That must be awful sitting in the back of that plane on the way home, was it, dear? What did you have, chicken or beef? Did you come British Airways? Don't even get a meal now, do you? You don't even get a meal on there. Absolutely shocking. Really is. Anyway, just a quick thank you to those of you that have shared the the show on their Facebook walls. Yes, multiple cameras. Yes, dear. We've gone very upmarket. There's another one behind me there. Look, you can see the whole studio now. Multiple cameras. It's been like this for a while now. God's sake, man. Didn't you know? Just shows how often you watch a show, doesn't it? Oh, dear. Let's just tell you. So today I went down to, I had a little appointment at the Royal Free Hospital in London. This was to see a dietitian. Those of you that know, I've got a bit of an IBS problem, a bit of a stomach problem, which isn't a like, you know, will you die type. It's not like a die type thing. What would you call that? Like a die type, die type thing? I don't know. But nevertheless, they're trying to help me along with that. So I was going to take the train this morning. Thank you, Justin. I'm loving the multiple cameras as well. You know, I think I should come back to your place and do your quiz, an exorbitant fee of money, and we could have multiple cameras set up in your pub and stream the quiz. How does that sound? Along with a bingo night. I can't come and see you next week. I'm away at my sister's, by the way. Okay, so I'll have to do the week after if you want to sort. Perhaps, if possible, a Tuesday. Can you do a Tuesday? Can I meet up with you on a Tuesday afternoon? Let me tell you, boys and girls, Justin is the man who owns the pub in Hemel Hempstead, a little pokey pub up north called the Steam Coach. But he does own that one, you know, unlike other people who, you know, just manage pubs. He owns his one. And I worked for him. I worked with him for quite a few years DJing. We had a very successful Friday night there for some years, and it just suddenly died. And it was very, very quick. Like one, on a, you know, if you had 100 people, I think it was more than 100, but if you had 100 people in there, so it was every week, 100, 100, 100, 100, and suddenly 10. And we never found out why, but it was general for the whole area. It just suddenly died. And he didn't want me to go, but I believe it or not, just down, I thought, I can't take any more money from you. So I left. And that's the reason I left. I've done some Christmas stuff with him. I used to do Christmas Eve. Now, as you well know, boys and girls, I don't work Christmas Eve anymore. I go to my sister's. I like to go to my sister's a day early and we do the whole church thing, you know, sing carols and all that. And it's all nice. It's all lovely. All very family, very family. But he's asked if we might be doing a bingo night up there. So that sounds quite interesting. So I'm going to meet him. Not next week, the week after, hopefully, and we'll have a little chat about that and see if we can do that. There you go. Look, he says, there, never worked for me. We always work together, yeah. But whereas I'm pretty calm, so if I'm doing a night, even if there's lots going wrong, you shouldn't be able to see it, you know? I'm pretty calm. Justin is all over the place. Oh, he's in a blind panic, let me tell you that. The only thing that panics me is when his bloody dogs come down the stairs because they don't like me. For some reason, his dogs hate me and I don't know why that is. And they're lovely dogs. They're Labradors. You wouldn't think it. They go mad when they see me barking their bloody heads off. Dear me. Dear me. There we are. Multiple cameras for a quiz. We could do something like that. We could indeed. This is a widescreen one. Did you notice it was widescreen as well, Justin? Yes, there we are. Anyway, so I was going to go to the hospital on the train. And I was going to go with my mate as well. So we were going to go on the train because he don't do trains. is when I don't do public transport. Now, I love doing trains. The only time I really go on a train is if I go to the Royal Free Hospital. So this was all sorted. And then coming towards the date, he said, oh, I need to be back by 3 o'clock. Do you think we'll be back at that time? And I'm like, well, you know, my appointment is for one. That's the other thing. Never tell him the time of the appointment. Because what he does is if you say, for example, it's a 1:30 appointment, which it was. It was a 1:30 appointment. If you tell him that, he will then look at his mobile phone and say, right, 1:30 appointment. Da, 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 da. OK, it takes an hour to get there. We'll leave at 12:30. No, we won't. We'll leave at 11:45. And then the row starts, you know. Oh, no, when leaving at 11:45. Why are you leaving so early? You don't need to. You'll be there too early. It doesn't matter. I need to be there on time. I need to leave myself space for things to go wrong, this, that and the other. Anyway, it's every single time that I or he have got an appointment somewhere and we both decided to go together because he often comes with me. And we have this row. So I've learnt now to lie. To lie. So if it's a 1:30 appointment, I'll tell him it's 11:45 or 1 o'clock. And I do it like that. I don't tell him the appointment time anymore. That's how it has to be. Otherwise, he starts moaning that he has to go. Well, don't come then if you don't want to come. Simple as that. Anyway, we were due to go by train. But in the last couple of days, he said, I think we should go by a car. Anyway, got to the car. And I really hate driving. But he's hurt himself. He's hurt. What's wrong with him now? Let me think. I think he's got a problem with his hands. Is it his hands or his arms? Or wrists. Wrists, that's it. So it's hurting him to drive. He said, do you mind driving? And I said, no, it's okay. I didn't really want to drive. I'll be honest. Oh, sorry, I'll drive then. Oh, big mistake. What a big mistake that was. Now, to be honest, the journey going there wasn't too bad, but you know, the sat nav told me I'd be there at 11:45, whatever. But it went on later than that, you know. Oh, we just got a call coming in here. Let's see who's on the line. London number. Hello, who's that, please? Oh, no, nope, hung up. Never mind. So had we have left at the time the sat nav, I would have been actually 20 minutes late, which means I wouldn't have had the appointment, because it said in the letter, if you arrive more than 15 minutes late for your appointment, you won't be able to have it. You'll have to rebook. So there you go. You know, the lie was well told, shall we say. The lie was well told. So we got to the hospital eventually. Had my appointment. There was no one in the hospital waiting room. I thought, this is a bit odd. Where is everyone today? We had to roll for it. It was on the first floor, clinic 5, room 5. OK, so I went and sat there. You've got this self-service check-in. Now, I don't know if you've got it where you are, but we've got this. Oh, there it is again. It's that London number. Let's try and take that again. Hello, who's calling in, please? Nope. OK, let's just block that now. There's someone mucking about. There we go. There we are. Right. Now, where was I now? Forgot what I was saying now. Oh, yes. So I'm in the hospital. I've checked in on one of those self-service check-in things. Now, it's like a glass screen, and it asks you. You put your letter from the hospital underneath it, and it reads the scan thing. And then it asks you your date of birth and your name and all that business. Is this your address? Is this your phone number and all that? And then it says, you have now checked in. Please go and take a seat. So then you go up to the clinic and then you go. I never take the seat at that point. I then go to the checker and say, I've checked in downstairs. And then they look at your thing. Oh, yes, I can see that you've checked in. Please go and sit over there. So it's not a waste of time, really. How much have they spent on these damn machines? And besides, you know, everyone has, you know, it's a hospital. People are ill in there generally. Now, who else has touched that screen, and what the hell have they got? The poor girl who had Ebola was taken there. She didn't self-check in by touching that screen, did she? For God's sake, man. God knows what diseases these self-service check-in machines are harbouring. That's the worry. Anyway, so my time came. And I went in to see the dietitian. And she was a lovely lady. Basically, my stomach problems are constipation, which is actually controlled by this powder, Cosmicol it's called, which keeps stuff moving. And you adjust it accordingly. So if you think, oh, I haven't been for a while, then you have some more. If it's not, if it's too much, then you have a bit less. So I don't want to be too graphical with this. But the other thing is I get like an area on my side which blows up. And it apparently fills with gas. Now, when I say I have a gas problem, that doesn't mean I'm like all the time. No, quite the opposite. It's the opposite. It's trapped. It keeps getting trapped here. So we've got this food fact sheet about irritable bowel syndrome and diet. And some of the things it says is try to eat 3 regular meals a day, yes. Cut down on rich or fatty foods, chips, fast foods. You know, a lot of it is common sense, to be honest. And a lot of it I'm doing already, if you see what I mean. But there's a couple of things that I found very interesting what she was saying. Avoid reheating starchy foods. Now, this, for example, could be rice. When she says avoid reheating these foods, it's not just something that you've made, right? So you've made your rice, you made too much of it. Okay, so you have what you want, put the rest in the fridge, bring it out the next day, reheat it in. Okay, don't reheat that. Very bad. Because it changes the chemical formula of the food. That's what she was saying. But it's not just the stuff you've done yourself. Example, Uncle Ben's rice. It's already been cooked once. And now this is one of the things I eat. In fact, I had some tonight. You know, wholemeal rice. Wholemeal rice with vegetables in it. As well as I had veggie burgers and some vegetables as well. But the thing is, that rice has already been cooked, so you are, in effect, reheating it. See, I didn't think of it like that. You know, to me, you get that bag out and you reheat it. Let's oh, there's a mobile call coming in, just a minute. Hello, who's calling in now, please? Oh, dear. Hello? Well, that don't sound very good, does it? That's a very bad, there was a problem with that. Try again. I think there was something wrong with your mobile phone there. If you want to try again, okay. So that's already been cooked. So you're reheating it. Now, I always thought, oh, well, you know, put a bag of rice in. That's the first time you cooked it. No, it's already been cooked. And it's the same for a lot of stuff. When you get that pie or stuff like that, it's already been cooked once. You are reheating it. And she says that's not a very good thing at all. That adds to the problem. You've got to eat really as basic as possible when you've got something like this. Why have I got it now? You know, it started about 18 months ago now. This IBS and stomach problem type thing. We've had cameras up there and scans and things. Can't find anything wrong. There's nothing, you know, nasty going on there. It's just one of those things. Let's try this phone again. Hello. Oh, that's better. Can it? Hello. Who's that?
Sorry to bother you, but you've been on my mind for about a week now.
Hello.
I can't tell you who I am because I have a secret crush on you.
Have you a secret crush? Oh, well, a lot of people have, I think.
The way it falls down to your shoulders.
What is
it? The way you giggle when someone says something funny. Not a big fan of the way you walk, though. It's a bit mannish. Where did you change that?
I can't hear you properly. What?
I do have a giggle when someone says
something. Hello? Can you speak into the phone?
I can't hear you properly. What?
Can you speak into the phone? Oh, it's hopeless, and it's some people are hopeless. Why can't we hear people all the time? Going to be one of those nights, is it? Now, where were we? Okay, so going back to this, yes. And there's other certain things, and of course, she was telling me which particular vegetables make more gas. That was a lot of the basilica family, like broccoli and cauliflower, baked beans, kidney beans, all stuff like that. And she says, either cut them down or you can take an enzyme to have with them, which apparently you get on Amazon. I think it's, what's it called now? Did she write it here? But bio, no, there's the, oh, I thought she wrote it down here. Hang on. tried to reduce manufactured foods on there. Now, she did say that. Where's the enzyme? Oh, she hasn't written it down. Or try with alpha-galactoside. I think that's it. That's the enzyme. Take one of those with it, and it cuts down the amount of gas. So it was a very interesting and worth doing. So we finished that, and then I drove home. Oh, God. And I forgot, it's the worst possible day you can drive in a year. It really is. The worst day you can drive in a year is Maundy Thursday. And it just took forever. We left the hospital about 2:30 in the afternoon. It wasn't late, 2:30. I stopped at the Tesco garage to get some cheap fuel. It's only £1.14 a litre. Bargain, dear. I must have saved at least 80 pence on my fill. So in there, and I had to buy a couple of sandwiches because we hadn't had time for lunch. I was starving hungry by then, so I had a couple of sandwiches and some of those mini cheddar things on the way home. And then we joined this bloody queue of traffic on the North Circular Road. And in the end, I think we got back at about 5:30 at night. It was, it must have been two and a half hours to get home, something like that. Absolute nightmare. This journey should take about an hour and 10 minutes if you're lucky. And then he wanted to have his hair cut, so we went. We'd spotted a very, very sexy hairdresser a couple of days ago. And he wanted his hair cut, and I was going to have mine cut as well. But he takes longer to have his because he has beard done and all that business. So he went there, and I went to Waitrose to get a little bit of shopping. Got my shopping, and then I walked around to the hairdressers, and he hadn't been seen yet. Anyway, as I sat down, we're sitting there. The bloke's finishing off some, and it's another bloke. It weren't the nice one, that was the good-looking one. This is some old git, you know, who was about 40. Yeah, I know it's only 10 years younger than me, but it's not a point, dear. We didn't want to be done by the 40-year-old. There was this rather delicious Mediterranean-looking man from Iran. Was he from Iraq? I think it was from Iraq. We wanted him to cut our hair, but he weren't there. Anyway, so Ronnie went in and had his hair cut, and I thought, well, I'll get mine cut in a minute. And at this point, I'm now incredibly tired. And I was watching him cut his hair, and I'm sorry, he was a bit rough. He had those cutters out, really pushing it. And I could see the back of my mate's head going red. It was awful. Red raw it was. And I have to say, he wasn't as good as the last bloke. The bloke who cuts it in Wokingham. So after he finished, he says, you're going to get yours cut. Well, he had to wake me up. I'd fallen asleep in the chair. I'd fallen asleep in the chair. On my life, I was so tired. So I declined to have my hair cut. And I said, are you here tomorrow? He said, oh, yeah, we're open tomorrow. And I thought, no, well, you won't be cutting my hair, mate. Not rough like that. Because some of them, they're really digging it in like that. And it hurts. I don't go to a hairdresser to get hurt. Thank you. So later on this morning, because it's 1:10, isn't it? How long have we been on? Nearly an hour, dear. Where does the time go, eh? Where's the time go? And so tomorrow morning, I'll probably jump on my bike and go down to Wokingham and have it cut there. Although I also want to go to Bracknell Town Centre tomorrow and collect my picture because I had a... You remember that picture I said on yesterday's show? I've got a picture in at the picture shop at the moment, which I bought off eBay. Lovely picture painted by some Polish artist, but it's ever so nice. Of course, it doesn't come on a frame. So I took it in there. I was going to have it framed, but apparently you have it stretched first. So they put it on this frame and they stretch it out. And the stretching's £120. God almighty. What is it? You know, it's just a bit of wood like that. What they nail to it and pull it out a bit. I could have done that myself. What a ripoff. Anyway, so I got a phone call this morning, just before I did this morning's show. I was going to go today to get it, yesterday to get it, but I didn't have time. So I'm going to maybe go this morning. I need to have my hair cut first before I go up to my sister so I could look all pretty. I like to look all pretty. But after we had his hair cut, I then dropped him home. And I got back here about 6 o'clock. Well, I was so tired. Of course, once again, I had to clear up the cat mess first. Oh, and then I just fell into bed at 6 o'clock. And I was so disappointed because I actually wanted to go to church tonight. They have a Catholic church have a special Maundy mass service where you get your feet washed. The priest washes the feet. It's something in the Bible. I won't go into it, but that's what it's all about. And of course, that was at 8 o'clock. Well, I got into bed at 6 o'clock. I woke up again at 20 past seven. I thought, oh, I can't go. I was so tired. I was so tired after the day. And it's the driving that did me in. I really did. And I said to Ronnie, I said, I'm never driving there again. That's the last time I drive in. It's just too much. Sitting there in that traffic all the time, it does my blooming head in. It really does. It's bad enough when I go to work. At least when you're going to work, you know you're getting money at the end of it, you know? Oh, so that was that. And 8 o'clock, around about 8 o'clock, I managed to drag myself out of my coffin again. Had something to eat downstairs. I had a problem with mixer, actually, a sound mixer at the quiz. If you were at the quiz, you would have noticed I couldn't get the microphone working. So I swapped the mixer out for a spare one while I was and that was fine. But I got the mixer out in the living room just before I come up to talk to you. I thought, well, I fixed the mixer first, see if I can find out what's wrong with it. It was a button. I didn't have the button turned. I had the wrong button turned up. Instead of having the volume turned up, I had the treble turned up. Very amateur, dear. Very amateur. Mind you. You want to see the back rooms of some people's pubs and the amateur setups they've got in there, dear. God, I don't dare name them to you. It's like something out of Tandy, some of them. Honestly, bits of sellotape and flashing lights all over the place, which do nothing at all. Unbelievable. So there we are. That was my day. Then I done that, played a little bit of piano, gave the cat a cuddle and come up and talk to you. So that's what I've done today, all right? Let's say some more of messages. Justin says, I'll come to you my DeLorean. He's got a DeLorean. Seriously, he bought a DeLorean, Justin. You know, he's always pleading poverty. It does make me laugh. Don't forget, you can call in still if you want to. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. 020-8144-3477. Or if you've got the Skype in, you can Skype in on United Kingdom Talk. That's my Skype name, United Kingdom Talk. Hello to Ben EM. Hello, Ben. Long time no see. Where do you do now? Just have a look on my wall. That'll tell you where I do the karaoke and the quiz nights. Not so much, hardly any DJing now. I'll do a little bit of DJing Saturday night, but it's mainly cabaret. I'm kind of in the background on a Saturday night. That's a nice little night at Central Station with cabaret as well. Now, who have we got this? Oh, I'll tell you who we've got this Saturday. If you're coming along to Central Station, an excellent show, The Drag with No Name. Really, he put some hard work into that. He really does. That's who I've got on Saturday night. OK. And then after that, I'll be driving straight to my sister's. Mark says it's Easter. Yes, it is Easter. What? No, it's not Easter yet. It's not Easter yet, love. It's Easter on Sunday. What is wrong with people? It's not Easter yet. It's Good Friday today. It's Easter on Sunday, dear. Do pay full attention, Mark. Dear me, is it Easter yet? Right. Let's do a couple of news stories for you boys and girls. Smoking in pub gardens. Now, that's one thing I noticed while I was at a hospital today. They've now stopped you smoking in the area directly outside the hospital doors. That stopped as well now. And actually, when they stopped the smoking in pubs and everyone's kind of moved outside to the front doors, I thought to myself, it won't be long before they stop this as well. Well, it looks like it's happening. In the Sun today, smoking could be banned in pub gardens under secret plans. The move, led by some Labour councils, would mean the £200 fine on lighting up inside boozers would be extended outside. Premises would be threatened with closure or clobbered with the existing £2,500 penalty. That's a lot of money, isn't it? Which pubs are fined for smoke for if they get caught with people smoking inside. I don't know how many pubs have been caught doing that, actually. Allowing people, and it can be difficult, you know. Certainly when that first came in a few years ago now, isn't it? and people would try and hide in toilets to smoke. You know, and your eyes can't be everywhere. It's all very well. I mean, some places, they have so many blooming cameras everywhere. Secret cameras all over the place, don't they? You know, but you can't have them in toilets. And people, the same as they do on airplanes, stupid people light up cigarettes in airline toilets and think they won't get caught. I mean, how thick can you be? You know, if you really can't stop smoking, don't fly. Why are you putting all us in danger? The blooming oxygen goes up there, so we're all a bit blown out of the sky. If it's not by ISIS, it's by you lighting a blooming cigarette. Dear me. Documents say show Labour-run Haringey Council in North London has been pushing for smoke-free areas to be extended to alfresco dining areas of restaurant and pub gardens. Now, me and myself, I'm an ex-smoker, although it's been a very long time. I gave up smoking, oh my word, it must be about 28 years ago now, so I suppose. And I hate smoking now. I can smell a cigarette a mile off. You know, it's a path kind of runs a little bit further back from my house, around the back there. And if someone smokes, I can smell it a mile off. I really can. The motion is backed by a Labour-led government organisation, London Councils, representing 32 boroughs, although the Conservatives say they're going to block it, saying it would trigger job losses. I can't see that somehow. I don't see how it's going to contribute to job losses, really. But I think it's a good idea, really. But I suppose people need somewhere to smoke, don't they? I don't see why they can't have their own room. But you'd have to have it where, I mean, a while ago, years ago, there would be smoking rooms in a pub, wouldn't there? I seem to remember it got to the point where there would be some pubs had non-smoking rooms and smoking rooms. But the trouble is, every time the door opened, all the smoke would just blow through. So if you had, I think you could have a smoking room in a pub, but what you'd have to do is have it in such a way that there wouldn't be one door leading into another. So perhaps you would exit the pub, go round the side and in another door. So there wouldn't be any smoke drifting in from one way to the other. I do feel sorry for the smokers who can't give up. On the other hand, I don't want to breathe in your smoke, you know. So it's difficult to know what to do, really, about the smoke. What do you think? Do you think we should have banned smoking outside pubs as well? And look at the mess, dear. You know, they put the ashtrays out there. Does anyone use them? No, they don't. Do you think we should ban smoking in pubs? Call in if you want to. 020-8144-3477. Okay. Let's there's an email here. Oh yes, I forgot this yesterday, didn't I? I didn't forget it. I just didn't get to it yesterday. There we go. Hello to Chris. Hello, Chris Lotz, who says, I'm a few episodes behind again. Went on vacation for a few days. Hope you had a nice time. Where did you go, Chris? Do you have a nice holiday? Where did you go? So please forgive me. Let me go. We didn't say that. So please forgive me. I'm answering some very old questions you've asked from your millions of viewers. And we do have millions of viewers now, boys and girls. Mainly due to you reposting the shows on your walls, which I thank you very much. It's always very, very kind of you to do that. Don't forget, once the live shows finish, it goes back up as a recording. And it's also on YouTube as well. All right. My YouTube channel is youtube.com/ChrisRinUK. If you're on YouTube and you want to join my Facebook thing, then you can do so. It's facebook.com/ChrisRinUK. Not on Periscope anymore. That was a bit of a waste of time, I think. So here we go. One, satellite navigation. You know I've been looking for another sat-nav thing. I think we've settled now on the TomTom Go, which was the... It's the new TomTom app, because the old TomTom app, which we loved very much, they are retiring it in September. So I've been looking around for another one. They've given me a free TomTom Go with free traffic updates for 3 years. So that's very, very reasonable. And we used it today and it was OK. You know, I tried Waze. I thought Waze was very good for London, but not so good outside London, because I got to a traffic jam in Bracknell on the way out to work one night, and it hadn't noticed it at all until it was on top of it. And by then, it's too late, you see. Can't do anything once about it then. So I was trying that. But Chris says, I love Google Maps. It's free. It's updated frequently. It's free. It tells you of alternative routes and how much time it can save you in traffic congestion. It's great in the States, so not sure how good it is on your side of the pond. The only thing I wished is that it had the speed limit for where you are. Oh, doesn't it have the speed limits? Ah. Yeah, that's a bit of a thing. Well, I mean, you should know the speed limit where you are. Although sometimes, you know, if you're not perhaps taking as much notice as you should do, you know, you might miss it going from, like, I don't know, 50 to 30 or something like that, mightn't you? Yeah, I see what you mean. I mean, we've got certainly some, the A40, it goes 60, it goes 70, I think 50, 40, 30. You know, so you've got to be aware that where that's happening. And they've got these average... Do you have any average speed cameras in the States? Oh, they're a bloody nightmare, they are. So it's an average speed. You can't speed in the section. You really can't. And we get more and more of those at the moment. Two, I love the Facebook status portion of your show. Makes me wish I hadn't given up my Facebook account last year. Yeah, that's something we've been doing. We don't do it all the time because actually... tonight, for example, I went through a long list of Facebook status updates. I couldn't find much of amusement or interest, really. There was a couple of bits here. There was a couple of bits I pulled out. One from Alex, our world-famous taxi bus driver, who says, the trouble with early shifts is it's so difficult to sleep for fear of being late for work, especially starting at 03:45 hours. Now, I know exactly what he means there. Now, I get up early on a Sunday, usually, to go to church, right? And I will go to bed 1:30, 2 o'clock, and I will set the alarm. Now, I never, ever sleep through alarm. So why is it on a Sunday night or a Sunday morning I have so much trouble getting to sleep, knowing that I need to be up at 7:20? And I do, so I know what Alex is saying. You see, that's a status update there. That's really the only one I could find that was of interest today. So there we are. I must say congratulations to Carl Waring, who looks like he's got a job now. So congratulations. Fantastic. And he can do it. And he can do it at home as well. So that's fantastic. Well done, Carl. I'm glad you got yourself a job. It's been a long time, hasn't it, mate? And it's hard work finding a job. Congratulations to Carl. You haven't told us what you're doing, though, have you? Let's have a look. Something he does from home that he's always wanted to do. But he doesn't tell us what it is. Oh, do let us know. We need to know what you're doing, Carl. Okay? So, yes, I like doing the Facebook status updates. But sometimes you look on there and there's nothing there. And other times you look and there's loads of them. So you never know. It's a bit hit and miss, really. Three, could I ask? My children have just got a ukulele from their grandma. I was hoping you could have Ray Reynolds back on the show and have him teach you and your viewers some basics of playing the ukulele. Well, I was given one. Just a minute. I think this was a birthday present from Ray Reynolds. I think it was from Ray and Johnny, and he bought me this. Okay. Now, it's not a... It is a ukulele, not like a... How would you say? A proper ukulele. But it is a ukulele, and it does play. And you can change the notes. Look. The only thing is, I don't really play guitar. How do you... I mean, I just feel so uncomfortable with it. See, the notes change. I mean... So, I could have him up here, I suppose, but I don't know how you hold it. No, there we are. It's a nice little thing, though, isn't it? Yeah, I'll ask Ray, actually. And he'd only be too happy to come up here with his ukulele and give us a little bit of a lesson, Chris. Okay, so there we are. We shall do that for you. Thank you, Chris, for the email. Always a pleasure to hear from you, sir. We'll close the phone lines now, boys and girls, I think. Yes, that's it. No more calls. One second. Let's turn that off. I like to switch off that before anyone else calls in. There we are. That's it. Done. Okay, so let's do today's birthdays then, boys and girls, and then I shall disappear for a cup of tea and some ginger biscuits before I go to bed. Happy birthday on this Good Friday to Kiki Dee. Hello, Kiki Dee. All right, sweetheart. Lovely Kiki Dee. I haven't seen you for ages. Kiki Dee's birthday today. She's a karaoke girl, an all-round nice person. Happy birthday to Kiki Dee. Happy birthday today to my old colleague, Mark Siddle. He's not as old as me. He's about 2 years younger than me. Mark Siddle, a very happy birthday to you, sir. Look at me doing this now. It's like doing afternoons at the Penny Farthing, isn't it? Eh? It's a bit like that, but without the music. Do you remember the complaints we had? Why does he talk like that? Well, aren't you worried he offends anyone? No. Such miserable people in this world. Happy birthday, Mark. Imanni Art is 36 years old today. Happy birthday, Imanni. I love your name. Imanni. Beautiful name. The young lady we said happy birthday to at the beginning of the show, Becky Petro McNabb. Happy birthday, Becky. Happy birthday, Becky. Donna Veitch is 44 years old today. Hope I've got your surname right, Dom. All right, happy birthday. Conrad Guest, happy birthday, Conrad. Trixie Licks, are you the one in Gran Canaria? Trixie Licks, that I did the voiceover thing for. I think you might be. Happy birthday, Trixie. And Nick Goldman, it's Nick Goldman's birthday today as well. So happy birthday to you all. Let's sing you the song, gang. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Okay. So there we are. 1:30 on a Friday morning and I've already done Friday's show. That's not bad, is it? So I'm very, very going to be very busy today. And I'll be going to the 3:00 mass. That is, it's a very sad church service we have in the Catholic Church on Good Friday at 3:00. It is remembering the day that Jesus has died on the cross for us. And that there's a part of the gospel that goes, and he bowed down his head and gave up the spirit. And it always does me in when they read that bit up. It really does. And we all kneel down and everything goes silent. So that's what I'll be doing today. And of course, tonight, it's Friday night, Good Friday night. I'll be hosting karaoke tonight at Central Station in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. That starts at 8:30 and finishes at 12 midnight. Free entry. It's a wonderful atmosphere in there, honestly. And we have such wonderful, wonderful people that come and join us to sing at the karaoke. All right. So once again, karaoke tonight at Central Station Bar in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. If you're not doing anything else, have a wonderful Good Friday, okay? And I'll see you again very soon. Thank you very much for joining me. Have a good night. Bye-bye now.